Hello students. Today, let's discuss about land revenue policies in India during the colonial period. This topic is very significant and very important too, in order to understand economic history as such. The primary objective of British East India Company was to earn through trade. It coupled trading privileges with political hegemony to advance in the final aim of subjugating India. The main burden of providing money for trade and profit of the company, the cost of administration and the wars of British expansion in India had to be borne by the Indian revenue. So broadly speaking, the British officials adopted three types of land revenue policies in India, that are permanent settlement, the Rayatwari settlement and the Mahalwari settlement. So in this lecture, let's examine the different ideological positions or colonial officials' understanding about Indian society and its people so as to adopt different land policies in India. And let's trace the impact of this land revenue policies and how different sections of Indian populations responded to it. First of all, let's discuss about the permanent settlement. Yes, permanent settlement was a new land revenue settlement introduced by Lord Cornwallis in 1793. Here the question is, why permanent settlement? Because the company wanted to fix the revenue permanently so as to get a regular and fixed flow of income for running their administration. So they wanted to fix the revenue permanently. Therefore, by that time, the company officials and European observers like Alexander Doe, Henry Petullo, Phillips Francis and Thomas Lowe, these were European officials. They were advocating for permanent settlement. And these officials were very much influenced by the ideology of physocratic school of thought, which was very much prevalent by that time in France. So here, what is physocratic school of thought? Physocratic school means giving importance or celebrating the concept of landlordism, that is acknowledging and accepting the concept of landlords. Here, Lord Cornwallis himself belonged to landlord class, landlord family. Therefore, it is obvious that he will support the landlord concept. Therefore, when they come to India, they were searching for this group of landlords, and in Bengal, the zamindars were identified as landlords, and these officials, they were trying to do the settlement with the zamindars. Therefore, in permanent settlement, the settlement was met with the zamindars, who were recognized as the owner of land and met to pay the tax. That was one reason to do the settlement with the zamindars. And another reason is that zamindars were the elite, were the privileged group in the society. Therefore, by supporting and securing their position, the zamindars will obviously support and they will be loyal to the colonial officials. This was another logic behind the settlement to be done with the zamindars. And another practical reason, such as it would be easier to collect revenue from small number of zamindars than from the innumerable peasants who would require a large administrative machinery. Therefore, in order to decrease the expenses and they were fewer in number, therefore the settlement was done with a small group of zamindar. That was another criteria to be done, to be the settlement to be made with the zamindars. Above that, company officials felt that agriculture, trade and revenue resources of the state could only develop by encouraging investment in agriculture. This could be done by securing right of property and permanently fixing the rent of revenue. Therefore, as the revenue is fixed permanently, so whatever the increase in production, the profit will go to the zamindar. So it is obvious that the zamindars will work for the improvement of agriculture. That was another factor. That's why the settlement was done with the zamindars. These were the criteria behind settlement to be done with zamindars. Coming next, then what are the areas of implementation of permanent settlement? First of all, permanent settlement was introduced in Bengal province, that is Bengal, Bihar, nowadays Orissa, and later extended to northern districts of Madras Presidency and districts of Varanasi. Coming to next point, the company fixed the revenue permanently and the revenue demand was very high, that is 10 by 11 of the revenue collected. So the zamindars were to give 10 by 11 of the rental they deprive from the peasantry to the state, keeping only 1 by 11 for themselves. The states of those zamindars who failed to pay were to be auctioned to recover the revenue. By 1928-29, about 19% of the cultivable land in India was under permanent settlement. Now let's come to the impacts of permanent settlement. Here, the zamindars were converted to mere collector of revenue. They acted as agents of company in collecting rent revenue from the ryots, that is peasants, and company controlled and subdued their authority and restricted their autonomy. They were deprived of their administration and judiciary power. And the company officials emerged as an alternative center of authority. Now, 75% of the zamindari rights were auctioned in Bengal within 5 years after the introduction of permanent settlement. Rent collection was perennial problem, and failure of revenue payment and accumulation of unpaid balance was very much prevalent by that time. However, the authority of the zamindari in rural areas did not totally collapse. Zamindars devised ways of surviving the pressure, such as fictitious sale. Now, land became a commodity, that is, land can be buyable, can be saleable, or can be mortgageable. And the cultivators became mere tenants at the will of the zamindars. The cultivators were now deprived of the rights to their soil and customary rights. Customary rights means like the use of pasture and forest land, irrigation canals, fisheries and household plots, and protection against enhancement of rent were some of the rights which were sacrificed. And also, no improvement in agricultural productivity at all. And above that, there were a new class of jotedars, that is rich peasants, were consolidating their positions in rural areas. So these are some of the important implications or impacts of permanent settlement. Now let's discuss about Rayatwari settlement. Rayatwari experiment was started by Alexander Reed in Baramahal in 1792 and was continued by Thomas Munro from 1801 in the ceded districts of Madras. By 1820, during Lord Wellesley, it became the general feature of company's land revenue policy. This settlement was influenced by the idea of conservatism. Conservatism means a socio-political ideology of promoting traditional social institutions. That is, in Madras province, by that time, there were no zamindars. The settlement was done with the ryots, that is the peasants. Therefore, Thomas Munro wanted to experiment the settlement with the ryots, not as to disturb the traditional way of living. Therefore, this was one philosophy or ideology behind implementation of Rayatwari settlement. And another important ideology is the utilitarian philosophy. Utilitarian philosophy means giving importance to utility. That means maximum utility for maximum number. That is maximum happiness for maximum number, a philosophy propounded by Jeremy Bentham. Here, his argument was that the intermediaries, that is the zamindars, were parasite to this structure. So let's eliminate the zamindars from this structure so that maximum utility can be utilized for the subject population. That was another factor for implementation of Rajwari settlement. And also, the economist David Ricardon theory of rent began to influence policy planning in India. The theory provided an argument to eliminate the zamindars and appropriate a last year of income for new acquisition of land by the state. So these three, utilitarianism, conservatism and Ricardon theory of rent, were some of the ideologies which bring up the Rajwari settlement. And the settlement was met with the peasants and thus created individual proprietary right in land, and the average income from different tribe of soils were estimated. The revenue paying capacity of Rajs were assessed, and a portion of it was fixed as the state seer. And major areas of its implementation were the Madras, Bombay, Deccan, Sindh, nowadays in Pakistan, Assam and Cutch province of British India. So these were the major reasons of implementation of Rajwari settlement. And here, the land were re-surveyed every 30 years and revenue rate increased. Thus, the revenue demand was no longer permanent. And by 1928-29, about 52% of the cultivable land in India was under this system. So this was Rajwari settlement. The settlement was done with the Rajs. Rajs were given individual proprietary right, and this system was implemented by Thomas Munro. And here also the revenue demand was very high. So these are some of the common features of Rajwari settlement. Now let's go to the impacts of Rajwari settlement. As commonly the revenue demand was very high, the peasants deserted their village and migrated to new places. In areas of poor soil and fluctuating rainfall, the problem was particularly acute. By 1930s, the problem became more severe as price of agricultural produce fell sharply. So, during natural calamities also, that is by the time of famine, flood or drought, peasants had to pay the revenue. Revenue could rarely be paid without a loan from a moneylender. So here, the position of moneylender became very significant in the Indian society. And the peasants' indebtedness was alarming by 1840s. Therefore, this high revenue demand and peasant debts were the general impacts of Rajwari settlement. So these are some of the impacts of Rajwari settlement. Now let's go to Mahalwari settlement. Mahalwari settlement was introduced by Lord William Bentinck in 1833. It was introduced in northwestern frontier province, the Himalayan foothills and Gangetic Valley, Punjab and central province, that is UP, Madhya Pradesh, etc. Here, the land were divided into mahals, that is village community or fiscal units. It means the revenue settlement was met with the mahals, the village community. And the village headmen, that is the lambadars, were responsible to pay the revenue to the state. Sometimes a mahal was constituted by one or more villages, and the state was to appropriate 2/3 of net income of the land, and the settlement was to be met for 30 years. And by 1929, about 29% of the cultivable land in India was under this settlement. So this is Mahalwari settlement. Now let's go to the impacts of Mahalwari settlement. As we know that revenue was very high, about 50 to 70% of the gross produce was given as revenue. and productivity decline because of fragmentation of farm lands. Here also, some landlords like talukdars were not completely eliminated, but where possible, joint proprietor right in land were vested in village community. Their main aim was to eliminate the zamindars, but here a group of zamindars, that is talukdars, were very much prevalent in that society. So that is, they can't eliminate the zamindars at all. And as a result, imperfect survey, overassessment, and confusion and corruptions were prevalent in this settlement. And to conclude, the common features of all these settlements was overassessment, as the prime aim of the company's government was to maximize revenue income. And as a result, there were arrears of payment, mounting prison debt, and increasing land sales and disposition. And now in these settlements, land became a commodity. That means land could be buyable, sellable, or mortgageable. Here, these policies has subsequently affected the rights, obligations, and power of different sections of population. Lastly, the effect of these changes had significant regional variations, as the land transfer could not fundamentally alter the structure of landholding everywhere. The agrarian society proved to be very resilient. Thank you.